Hi, everybody, and welcome to the overview for TeamForge 16.7. My name is Arnold Fulton. I am the technical account manager. I reside in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm responsible for all the customers here in the Southeast. So today what we're going to do is we're going to go over a brief overview of what's in TeamForge 16.7. I also want to talk about what's new in 16.7. And we'll also take a quick view of the sneak peek of what's coming up, which is going to be some really exciting new features and functionality in TeamForge. And just so you guys know, we're on release 16.7, and if you are a previous customer, an existing customer of TeamForge, the last release this year, we decided to change our release structure. Before that, we were doing 8.1, I think 8.2 was the last release in December. And then in this year, in 2016, we have decided to do quarterly releases. So you'll see that reflected in the release number. So we went from 8.2 to a 16.3, now a 16.7. Next release will be a 16.10. So you didn't miss a bunch of releases between 8 and 16 if that's the case. So we are on 16.7 now, soon to have a release 16.10, and we are using CollabNet TeamForge to manage those releases. So we have our own releases and sprints and doing our own agile development. Okay. So I do want to talk about what's new. There's some really nice new features in CollabNet TeamForge, and you can also see that after this recording is done. You can go and grab those and look at them and take your time with them. They're at help.collab.net, where you can go and get those. You can download a data sheet. There's some more information there. You can get to this recording as well as some previous recordings on that same area. Okay, so we have the version scheme menu changes. I already talked about that. But we also had some changes in processes and methodology support, and I'm going to be walking through some of that today. As you know, TeamForge supports an agile development method as well as if you're doing waterfall, but you can also create your own. And that is a completely customizable process if you want to change that, but it is available out of the box, so you can start using it right away. But everything you see is completely customizable and configurable, so you can add your own fields, you can change the workflow. All of that capability is there, and it's pretty easy to do that. So I'll be walking through some of that today. I am not going to do any of the administration. If you do want to have more information about the administration, I will be glad to take that offline at another time. So I do also want to talk about source code management. One of the nice things about TeamForge is that we support multiple methods of source code management. So as you know, we support Git, which I'll be using today. We support Subversion. We support CVS. And I believe that we are probably one of the only vendors out there that support all of those different tools and even in the same area. So you can have repositories that are in Git. You can have repositories that are in Subversion at an enterprise level. So we add a lot of enforcement around what you can do with those repositories and how you can lock them down, especially if you have teams that are working in remote locations. So if you have teams that have different responsibilities, if you want to give and you want to give those teams different permissions, you can do that very easily in TeamForge, not only at the repository level, but actually at the branch level. So I can have my team here working in Atlanta. I can have a team working offshore, I can have a team on the East Coast and West Coast and give them all different permissions. So if that's something that's important to you, that's something that we do very well, especially if you guys are in an environment where you have to go through audits and control. Okay. We also have extensibility in TeamForge so that you can integrate with a number of different tools. I'll be talking about some of those today. We're going to talk about how you can build your entire platform around different tools that you might already be using. Like, so supposing that I have a lot of customers that are using Jira, and we can use Jira with TeamForge. We can use different build tools. And I also want to talk about our DevOps solution, which is coming out shortly. So those are things I want to talk about today. One of the things that also has changed is our licensing structure. So in the past, there was basically two different licenses types that you can get. There was a version control license where you just be using version control, such as Git and Subversion. But now there's also an ALM licensing structure. But we've added to that in 16.7 the DevOps as part of the 16.7 release. So some of the things that you will see that has changed is that now you'll have support for Subversion and Git. You have different license types if you're doing Subversion Git versus ALM, which we're going to talk about that whole structure today, and if you have DevOps. So you're going to see some new options under the administration about who can have what types of licenses, and different users can have different types of licenses, and you can have more than one type of license. For example, I could be an ALM user as well as have a DevOps user, or I could be an SVM user as well as have a DevOps license, or I can have a version control and still also have a DevOps license. So those are all new options that are available in 16.7. Okay. Around process and methodology, today we're going to talk about our agile development workflow and how you can really build out your process and do your agile planning. In addition to that, we offer that you could have different teams working in different methodologies. So certain teams could have an agile development workflow, whereas another team, maybe I can have my business development team who is doing something completely different, they could still be working in a waterfall methodology. I don't think I want to have one team working in both, though. That can get pretty complicated. But most of the organizations that I deal with today, they do have some combination of agile methodology going on in their in the development teams as well as waterfall. You can also have some hybrids, or you can even create your own. One of the new things that we've enhanced in 16.7 is our support for is our Kanban support. So you can do that at the task level. You could do it at a story level. You can do that at an epic level if you wanted to. You can do that at the requirements management level. But we'll talk about that more as we go through the demo today. So that's one of the nice things about TeamForge is that it now has a really nice built-out Kanban support. We also integrate with external process tools such as Jira. Like I said, that's one of the very popular tools out there that people are using today, and they want to continue using that, and we want you to continue using that. What we do is that we can add that into the lifecycle so that now we can get a complete traceability of what's happening with those Jira tickets. For example, I can create my ticket in Jira, I can see it in TeamForge, I can associate it with the work code, I can associate it with my requirements and documents that I might keep in TeamForge, as well as I can see where that ticket went. So one of the nice things that we're going to look at today is if you are having to go through audits and you want to be able to trace where that ticket is. So a lot of people ask me what's happening with this particular requirement, what's happening with this Jira ticket, is that now we can actually trace that through the entire life cycle. Here's the ticket. Here's the requirement that it's associated to. Here's the source code that it's been associated to, who checked it out, what modifications were made. I can do a side-by-side comparison and see what changes were made to the actual source code. I can see, did we have a code review? Did the code review pass? Did it have to go through multiple code reviews? At some point in time, you probably want to do a build on that. Who did the build? Was it built out completely? Was the build successful? And I can see all this through associations in TeamForge. So I can get a complete picture of what's happening, or what we call the one true view of what's happening with this Jira ticket. Okay. Then we also have activity streams. So I can review activities across the entire development pipeline. So just like I just mentioned, I have a view, an activity stream, where I can see all of these things that happen. I say, here's the ticket. Here's where we did the changes, who made the changes, date and timestamp, what changes were made, did it build, where is that build? I can click on the button, go look at the details of that build. Did it fail? Did it succeed? I can get all that information from my activity stream. Okay. With TeamForge, we also give you the capability to be able to extend your development platform to all these other different tools that you're using. So you say here, it's TeamForge, and from TeamForge, I can really plug that into my entire development pipeline and see exactly what's happening in those activity streams. So within that activity stream, I can say, here's my Jira ticket. From that ticket, I can say, here's who did the build, how did they do the changes, did they work in Eclipse, were they working in Visual Studio. I can see all of that information very quickly. How did we do the deploy? What did we use for the build? Did I use Jenkins? So people using TeamCity? Are they using large file systems? So all of this information I can see inside of TeamForge. So we give you this thread to put everything together, give you this nice activity stream, so you get the one true view or the one true history of everything that's happening in your development environment. Okay? And I'm just going to do a few more slides, and I'm going to jump into a live version of TeamForge so we can see what's happening. But I do want to talk a little bit about the source code management, in that we are one of the few vendors out there that give you a unified code review and support across Garrett and Git pull requests. So we're going to see some of that today. Inside of the Garrett code review, you also have the opportunity to do inline commenting so that you can actually put comments on individual lines of code. So when people are going there and looking at and see, I wanted to change this code from red to blue, you can put details in there about exactly why you're doing that so that nobody has to guess about what was changed, or nobody has to go and try to find somebody and track somebody down and see what was changed. All that information you can put right there inside of the code so you can have inline commenting. One of the other things that we added in Git is large file system capability. Before, most systems who are using Git are limited to what Git offers. So in 16.7, we've also extended that to large file system functionality. One of the things that we've always had, but we've enhanced, is our history protect features. And what that means is that if somebody goes in and tries to change something or delete something, you can always recover from it. You can bring it back. And it's not such that it's just on one file now, and you can bring back entire repositories at one time. Okay. We already talked about this. I won't cover that again about the accessibility with different tools. But one of the things I do want to reiterate is that we can work with a lot of different tools out there. So if we have customers that are using Jenkins for their builds. We have people that are using TeamCity for their builds. So you can get that continuous integration. You can have it automated such that if a user does a commit or whatever action you choose, but if that user does a commit, it could automatically kick off the Jenkins build. That Jenkins build can then be can activate a review if you want to do that. So all these things we're going to take a look at today. We also work with Jira, like I talked about before. We're going to see a little bit of that today. I'm not going to actually open up Jira, but I think I can show you some Jira tickets that already exist just so you can see what it looks like. And you still get that traceability inside of Jira. I'll talk about that as we go along. We also integrate with Chef for deployments. And some of the things that are coming that are listed over on the right is there's going to be more Jenkins improvements so that I can actually see the traceability views, and we'll see that in Jenkins so I don't have to switch to different tools. I can have my developers stay in one tool and do all their work, get to all the information that they need without having to change to a bunch of different screens or change to a bunch of different tools, a bunch of different platforms. Everything's going to be right there in front of you. Okay? I'm going to come back to this screen later. But with that, I'm going to go ahead and jump into TeamForge. Okay. So TeamForge is web-based. So the users, they would pull up the URL, and they'll be asked to log in. And those users are controlled by the administrator. The administrator will add the users into the system. They will give those users different permissions or different types of licenses. And then those users will see a dashboard or a work area that's associated with them. So I have my workspace. And what I'm going to do today is I'm actually going to build on top of a demo that Phil did a couple of weeks ago, and I'm going to act as maybe more of an auditor as opposed to going in and make a bunch of changes so we can see some of the things that exist. So when you log in, depending on who you are, you might see different types of screens. So right now I'm logged in as an administrator for this particular project, and it gives me information about TeamForge. I can click on the link and get to TeamForge training. I can get information about Git, information about the version. We offer different desktops that you can get to. So, of course, we work with Eclipse, Visual Studio desktops. There's one called GitEye that you can use. And, of course, some people still use command line, believe it or not. But we work with all of these different tools that are out there, including HP QC. But when I log in, I get different statistics that is important to me. So each user, by the way, can create their own dashboards if they want to when they log in. They might see different information. And I'll just give you an example of some different types of things you might look at. So, for example, if I'm looking at this project, I might see information related to these artifacts. And the nice thing is that this is one panel where I can go get information about the project. So in TeamForge, we offer these dashboards. I'm going to click on this dashboard over here. That's on my homepage. And that's the information that I want to see when I log in. Okay. So like I said, each user can have their own different dashboards that's important to them. But the important thing about this is that now I don't have to go around and asking people information about what passed or what failed or where things are in the pipeline. I can quickly come here and build out these reports, get you the information that I want to see very quickly, and it's going to help me do my job very quickly. I can see information about the different planning folders that I have. So in particular, I might be looking at release one, sprint one right now, and I might want to see information about the burn down charts and burn up charts, and all that information is here, and I can get to it very quickly. Okay. So with that, let's say that typically when you are working in a project, it's going to start with some requirement somewhere. And in TeamForge, we give you lots of different options in the ALM. So let me just start with source code first. I just want to touch on that just a little bit. So in TeamForge, for every project that I have, so TeamForge, by the way, is project-centric. And inside of that project, you're going to have users. You're going to have all the administration that goes with that project. You're going to have the ALM if you're using that. But first and foremost, you're probably going to have the repository that goes with that. So in this particular project, I happen to have a couple of different Git repositories as well as a Subversion repository in this same project. And that might be different teams or different teams that are working in dispersed geographic locations that can get to this information. So I'm going to be working in this particular project today. And if you click on it, you can quickly see I can go in here and say, well, here's the changes for this particular project or for this repository. I can see who made the changes. I can get a complete tree of everything that's happened to this. And in particular, today I'm concerned about there's a requirement in my user document. Let's go take a look at that. So in here, I have my source code, which I'll come back to in just one moment, but I also have documents that I can keep inside of TeamForge that's going to help me drive my development. So in here, I have a document that's specifically for all my user stories or my requirements. And if I click on that, I can actually go out here and look at the document itself. So this is the document that's inside of TeamForge, and I'm more concerned about a change that my guy Phil made a couple of weeks ago. And he had a requirement in here, and it was from section 2, it's called achieve an increase in the average rating, blah, 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 blah. And he has a story that's associated to this particular requirement, and I'm concerned about I want to go out and be able to trace that particular requirement and see where it is, what's happened to it, has it been built, what changes have been made, so on and so forth. Okay. So I'm going to go back to TeamForge, and I'm going to go to Trackers. Okay. So inside of TeamForge, this is where we really get into the meat of all the planning folders in the actual development environment itself. So first of all, I have a list of trackers. So again, out of the box, you get epic stories, tasks, test cases, defects, impediments. You can create your own. And each one of these trackers has a work item or a workflow associated with that different type of work item. So my workflow for a story might be completely different than the workflow for a task. Okay, so a task, by the way, is something that a user is going to work on, is going to associate that code to it. You might think of a task as a unit of development that's assigned to one person to make some changes in some small amount of time. So when I say small amount of time, that gets kind of ambiguous. So usually when I say small amount of time, that's, if I can't do my task in more than 3 days, I might split it up into multiple tasks. And it's just a way for me to keep track of the work that I'm doing. And inside of my stories, I'm going to break that story up into multiple tasks. So I'm going to have, in this order, for my agile development environment, I have my ethics, I have my stories, and then my stories are probably going to have a task or multiple tasks associated with them. Okay? So let's just take a look at what one of these things look like. If I go into stories, I can see a list of user stories that has been created. And I can see here's the one that I was looking for. It's called Achieve and Increase. That comes directly from that requirement in that user document. And I can see Phil is the one that's working on it, still in development. At least he says it's still in development. It has a high priority. And I can go out and look at this particular story. So let's just click on it, take a look at it. And it has a title, the description. So the title is kind of a short, abbreviated version of what is this particular story. Is likely to show up in some report. So if I had a report that says list all of my stories, I probably would see that short title. But I can give it a long description too to go with it if I want to give it more details. It tells me what data was submitted, when it was modified, what group it is associated to. So here are all the fields that are associated to my task. And again, these are completely configurable. So if you want to add additional items, additional fields to the task, you can do that. If you want to change the statuses, or if you want to change the drop-down values, you can change those. But in this particular case, it's not associated to a group. It's in development. I mean, it's in development still as the highest priority. And again, like I said, these are configurable. So this one shows that it's highest is 1 and lowest is 5. And maybe you got something else. Maybe you got red, yellow, green that you want to use for your priorities, but those are all completely configurable. And it is assigned to, and this was not actually assigned to anybody at the moment, but I could click on here and assign it to someone. So I'm not going to change that just yet. And it's currently in sprint 1. So let's go take a look at that and see where it came from. Okay. It has points associated with it. And this, if I click on this checkbox, it allows me to do a summary of points from all the children to a parent, or I can say calculate all of the points from the children in this case. So in this case, it would calculate all the points from the task that are associated to this particular story. Let me go back. Okay. So that's what a story looks like inside. You can also have associations. Let me let this build out just a little bit. And what this is, I can associate this story to different things. For example, I can tell here that Phil had already went out and created an association to the document where the original requirement came from. So I'm just letting that build out for a second. You can just create the association by clicking on the Add button, and it will give you a list of associations. So here, I can see that here's the story, here's the document. I can actually see that those changes down here if I wanted to do that. If I wanted to add a different association or additional associations, I would just click on the Add button, and it would bring up a list of items that I could associate it with. So this is how he created that association to begin with. You select that, click Next, and it creates that association. So what you're getting here is not just showing you just some picture of associations. It's that you're building out this traceability, this complete traceability from the requirement itself to the story. And by the way, if you were doing the story in Jira, as opposed to doing it in TeamForge, it would still show up here the same way. You would see it as a Jira task. I'll show you that in just a moment. Okay. Let me go back. If they have any dependencies, so you can also have dependencies. So if there's things that are blocking you from doing something else, for example, maybe you have a dependency to make a database change before you can make the code change, then you can have those dependencies show up as part of that story. If you have attachments that you want to include with it, maybe somebody has a diagram that they want to attach, you can do all these different types of things here. I don't think this one has any associated with it, but I'll just come here and say add attachment, and I can add an attachment to this particular story. Okay. Let me go back to my trackers. So that's what the trackers look like. A lot of people call them work items. In TeamForge, we call them trackers. And from here, now that I have my list of stories and my tasks, so you come in here and you build your tasks, you build your stories, and so on and so forth. Then I can go to my planning. Oops, let me go back here for a second. I can go to my planning folders. So what I have here, of course, is the group folder. Everybody's going to have a group folder where everything is going to exist. And in an agile development environment, then you're going to have, typically you're going to have some folder that's going to have all your backlog. So for me, that's the project name. I have one called CTF Mobile M. So that's my backlog. And my backlog includes all of the stories that has not been assigned to anything else yet. So sitting in my backlog waiting on me to do something with those. So I have my backlog, and this one is broken up by release 1, release 2, release 3. And for each release, I might have a couple of different sprints. So, again, these are all configurable by you. So in our development lab, when you go and look at this, you'll see something like the CollabNet TeamForge release, and then you'll see a sprint for release 1, a sprint for release 2, a sprint for release 3, something very similar to this. But this is all configurable by you. You can create new ones. You can edit the ones that are here if you don't like the names and so on and so forth. But those are all configurable by you. So once you have this, then I can start building this out and see, well, how are we really going to work on this? I've got this list of stories or this list of requirements that we need to do something with. And then I'm going to go to my planning folder. I'm going to say for my backlog, I want to start putting things in release 1, and I want to put some things in release 2. Okay? So, for example, I created a story earlier. I'm not going to create a new one. You could create a new one if you wanted to. But instead of creating a new one, I'm just going to take the ones that already exist. And I'm going to say, I want to move this from release 1 to release 2. And I would just do that by doing a simple drag and drop. Or maybe I want this to be back over here. I want that to be in release 1. But I also want to expand this application to mobile use. I want to put that over here in release 1. I could do those things very simply. I'm not going to move that one just yet. I don't want to move it just yet. I can reprioritize them just by dragging them and dropping them. So it's really easy to use the interface. I think it's pretty almost intuitive. I don't think you need a lot of training for it, for some of the features. But here's one that I created. It's assigned to me. From here, I can see the tasks that are associated. So I already created a task. I'll come back and show you how to do that. So I can see the children that are associated to it. But here, if I have these things in my release 1, the next thing I want to do is start putting them in the different sprints. So I might change my view. I'm going to change my view just a little bit. So instead of looking at the backlog, I'm going to look at release 1. And then I'm going to look at sprint 1 and sprint 2. Okay. So from here, I can see how these things are going to build out. I can say, for example, here's release 1. And I'm not going to do that one in sprint 1. Sprint 1 looks like it's already full. I'm going to move that one to sprint 2. So I can move it over there. Or whatever it is I feel like I want to do with it. Okay. Maybe I'm not ready to do that one just yet. Maybe I want to take a look and see some of these other things first. Okay. Okay. And maybe I'll move this one out of sprint one back to here. Maybe I don't want to do that just yet. Okay. So these are some of the things I can do. From here, I can start tracking what's happening, and I can start moving them through the workflow. So here's my release one. And I can see that maybe I want to take this, and I can put it in development, and it would show up over here. So right now it's in progress. And I can just move these things through tracking, and it would show up in different places. So from here, the next thing I want to do is I want to task it out. So I've got these stories. But now I want to do some real work in development. I'm going to say I want to create a task. So all I did was just click on the plus button of the story, and I'm creating a child task to go with that story. So I'm going to say this is task for monitoring . You can give it some description if you want to do that. That can use verbose if you want. So now I've got my task. It shows up here. It's under consideration. Let's go and edit this task. Let's assign it to myself. So I have permission to assign this to other people based on your permissions in the tool. We'll determine what you can do with it. So I'm going to go ahead and assign it to myself. I'm going to say it's high priority. Maybe I can give it some points. No, that's not getting any points yet. But you can give it points, and those points will roll up into the story. If you have teams, which you can create teams, you can assign it to a specific team, and those teams will have specific permissions that they can or cannot do. So I'm going to update that. So now I have this task. Okay. So what we're doing is that we're building out this requirement. We started with some requirement from our user document. We created the story to go with it, or stories that goes with it. Each story would have a task or multiple tasks that goes with it, and then I can move that through the development lifecycle. Okay. So now that I have this task, I can go out and start doing work, and I can do that from a number of different interfaces. I can do it in Developer Studio. I can do it in Eclipse. I can do it from a command line, whatever I choose to do it from. Well, I'm going to show you some things here. I'm going to bring up my Eclipse. At least I think I'm going to bring up my Eclipse. There you go. Okay. So inside of Eclipse, in Developer Studio, by the way, and GitEye, you're going to see a lot of the same features that we just saw in the interface. So I have this thing that's called the CollabNet perspective. So you would add the CollabNet perspective to your view. I happen to be using Git. But in the CollabNet perspective, you're going to see all the same things that we saw before. I can see my documents for this particular project. Again, this is broken out by project. So here's the same project I'm working on. I can see the documents that are associated with this particular project. I can see the same planning folders that we were just looking at. So here's release one, release two, release three, this sprint one, and so on and so forth. All that information is still here. I can see the actual source code that I'm working with. And then I can actually make changes. I can actually go to, I already have it open, but I can actually go to the code, start making changes. I can see the stories and the tasks that are assigned to me. Let me scroll down just a little bit. So I'll see all the same information that we just saw. And what I want to do is I don't want to do a lot in here because I don't want to turn this into a developer session. But here you come in here and you make your changes. When you're done, you save, you commit, and your changes will be associated to that task. So that's kind of like the life of a developer in TeamForge. Is in everything they could do, they could stay in here and do everything they need to do. They could come here, click on the site browser. All the same stuff we were just looking at, you could do it right from the interface. So here, I'm still in Eclipse, by the way, but I can see all the same information that I was just looking at in different ways. I can see it through the browser. but all of this is inside of Eclipse. It's just expanding windows and changing windows. I can see my task, I can see my planning folders, all the different things. I guess I need to log in, but all the same things we just saw, I could see from here. Okay. When I finish, I would save, commit, make my changes, and everything I can do from developer here. Okay. So with that said, as I'm doing this, I'm going through and I'm building this out. Let's go back to my browser for a minute. I just want to show you guys something. So here, in my ALM suite, there are different things that I could do here. So we talked about our trackers. We talked about the documents that we can keep. So here we can keep documents. The nice thing is that we have all these different aspects of your pipelines, your development pipeline. We can keep the documents. You can have wikis associated with your project. You can have discussion threads associated with your project. If you're using binaries, you can have those associated with your projects. A lot of people want to know, can I keep my binaries? So, yes, one of the things that's new in 16.7, like I said, is that we also have support for large file support. So you can keep all of those binaries inside of TeamForge now. Okay. So as we're going through, you see how we make the changes. The first thing we did, just want to reiterate just a little bit. We go back, we set in my trackers. You might see a list of all my trackers with different views. And for each one of these, by the way, for each one of these planning folders, we call them planning folders. So there's a planning folder for my release. There's a planning folder for each grant. And for each one of them, I can get different information about that particular planning folder. I can see things that are open by priority. And, of course, these are all created in my reports. I'll come back and show you what that looks like. But I can go back and create these reports so I can have different things show up in my view and get information about what's happening to my development project. I don't have to go chase somebody down and ask them what they're doing, which is actually stopping them from doing work. I can actually get all the work right here, and it's live. It's real time. I don't have to worry about if somebody go out and create spreadsheets and extract all the information and put it somewhere, and then by the time you do all that information is stale. So this is all live information. You can export information to like an Excel file or a CSV file if you want to do that, but it's not necessary to get most of these reports. But just so you know, you can do things outside of the tool if you want to do that. I have lots of customers. They take the data and they want to do other analysis to it. So you can do that if you need to. Okay. So the first thing we do is we went out and we created our planning folders. And then we did the planning itself. We moved things from the backlog to each release, from the release to the sprints. We can take a look at the tracking folders so we can see where everything is. Apparently I don't have anything right there, but I can come in and see where everything is for release one. You can do it by release. You can do it by sprint if you want to do that. I don't think I have anything set up just here yet, but you do your Kanban chart so you can base it on storage. You can base it on tasks. Any of your trackers, you can base your Kanban chart on. Okay. So you can see where is it now, has it been started, is it in development, is it in testing, is it in QA? And again, all of this is configurable so you can have it match your environment. So let me come back and look at something. Where I started today is I set up this user requirement that I wanted to go and take a look at called Achieve Monitoring that Phil worked on, Achieve Increase, that's the one. He had this story called Achieve Increase from the actual requirement, and I'm going to get more information about that. So if I'm the product manager and I want to get more information about what's happening in my project, number one, I can create reports or I can have reports created, and they'll always just sit on my dashboard. If I want to look at one thing in particular, like I have an auditor that comes in, and they want to know exactly what happened with this thing called Achieve Increase, I can go to this particular work item into this particular tracker, this story. I can see what's here. Let me scroll down just a little bit. I think we already talked about this. I can see the traceability associated with it. But I can also go to the actual repository. Let me go to this one. I can go to the actual repository, and I can see changes that are being made. So I can come here, and I can look at the changes. I can go to a graph view. I can see exactly what has changed. Let me go back to one that's a little bit more exciting to look at. That one was just a straight one. But if I have different branches, I can see those branches and where they came from and when they got merged back in, who actually did them. So I can see that Phil did a lot of work on this particular project. He made some changes here. I can actually go and look at this. It was a creature branch that he created. He made some changes on it, merged it back in. Then there's another branch that was created here called Configure. You can see those different things that are happening. I can go to the branches themselves and see exactly what happened. Oops, let me go here for a second. Go back. That one. Good branches, merged. And I can also see all the different reviews that have happened. So in here, as Phil was going through his changes, or when Phil was going through his changes, I can see everything that was happening with that particular change. I can see here's an artifact that was created to have to augment. I can see when they were created. Here's the one we were looking for. It's called Achieve 1. That's the one I was just following from the requirements document, which is 28 days ago. So I can go back in time and see exactly what happened. Here's one I wanted to show you that he created not from a TeamForge artifact, but this actually came from a Jira artifact. So you see those will show up in here often, just like you do everything else. They would show up in here. But if I click on this one, I'm more concerned about this thing today called Achieve One. I want to trace it all the way through and see exactly what happened with it. So I saw the story. I saw the task. I'm going to go in here and see what happened exactly with it. So now I'm looking at the review process that happened with this particular story. It's called Achieve One. There's one file associated to it, this file. I can see exactly what he changed. So he added, looks like, two Achieve at the end of that line. And there were some inline comments. He said, wow, this is good. I don't see any change to the code, just text. But just text, so that I can see that the user actually put some details or some notes in here for the users to look at. So I get this unified side-by-side, as I can click on this, by the way, and I can have unified reviews, so it's all embedded, or I can have the side-by-side reviews, okay? If he had a commit message, that would show up in here. So this is details about the commit itself. So I can see everything really that's happening to this particular requirement. I'm looking at who did it. I'm looking at the user story. I'm looking at the file that was changed. I can see the actual changes. If the user made any comments, I can see all of that. If there's messages, I can see exactly what happened with those messages. Anything else in here I want to take a look at? Okay. And I can jump back to the artifact pretty quickly if I wanted to do that. And I can see the associations on this particular artifact. Okay. So just to reiterate again, we start with the user story. And again, I can have that in Jira. I can have that in TeamForge. I can have it traced down to the actual code changes made by the developer, using different interfaces. So that could be Eclipse, that could be Developer Studio, it can be from the command line, whatever the case might be. So I can see all those different things. But let's see some other details about what happened here. So here is the actual task that was modified. Okay. And I can see all the associations to it. I can list out the trace and get more details if I want to see that. limit pet build out. Is that a second? Okay. So now, what's nice is I really get to see all the details about what really happened in this particular situation. So here I see all the details. Here's the actual task. So I can see the summary for the task, the chief one by field. I can see date and timestamp. I can see some of the fields associated with that task, like what priority was it. It's associated to this particular story, which is called Achieve an Increase. So that was kind of like the where we started. We started with the document. So this was a user document that had my stories, my list of stories or requirements that I wanted to build out. I create that story. From that story, I've got the task. From that task, I can see the actual changes that were made. So I can see the change IDs made by Phil. I can see where the build took place. I could actually click on this build and go get more information about the build if we wanted to do that. What else? I can see the review. All that information is here. So it's very nice that I can easily get the complete traceability. I also have something that we call the activity stream. So I can see every single thing that's happening. Here's what I did today that I can go back in time and see exactly what happened. Here's some other stuff I did. But I can actually go all the way back and see exactly what's happening in this project at any point in time. And I can go back and see those features. I can see here's a Git review that happened. Here's a check-in that happened. Here's another review. But I can go to my activity stream and see exactly what's happening. So this is actually phenomenal if you guys are doing audits and you need to go back and see exactly what's happening. Here's the actual build. I can actually click on that. If I had access to the build server, I can go look at those things and see exactly what's happening. Okay. So in here, let me just see if I can, if there's anything else I want to talk about. I do want to talk about the reporting structure or reporting features. So here's a list of reports for this particular project that's been built out. But you can actually create your own. And they're pretty easy. There's some widgets in here, lots of different widgets that you can get to. There's some activity reports. There's some agile reports. And they are pretty simple to use. Here's one that we saw before, for example. And I'm not going to actually save it, but I'll just give you a quick idea and give it some title. Some description. Tell it which project that you want to use, a little thing we want to use. If I want to use this particular project, and go down and grab whichever project that I want. You can tell it the time frame that you want, like is it the last week, 2 weeks, 30 days, 60 days, 90 days. So you can fill those in. And then when you finish, you would just create that report. And you have the option of making it either public or private. So if you make it public, that means that all users with that can view reports in within your project, they can see that report. If you make it private, then that report is only for you. So within the project, by the way, there's so many different permissions that you can give people, whether they can have access to the code. Can they see the code? Can they read the code? Can they modify the code? Can they do it on certain branches? Can they do it on certain repositories? Can they see certain reports? So you have a lot of granularity when you're assigning permissions to that project. And you just create, I can do a preview if you want to see what it looks like. I don't know if this one has any real data, so it might be a surprise. But you go ahead and build that out, and you can preview it. If you didn't like it, then you can modify it, make changes to it, come back if you like it. So it doesn't have any real data. But you can go ahead and create that and save it. You can put it on your dashboard if you wanted to. Okay. So with that, we're coming up on the top of the hour, and I did want to leave just a little bit of time for questions if you guys have questions. Let me go here. Okay. So before we take questions, I do want to talk about this particular workflow. So this is kind of what we did today. We started with our actual requirements. So maybe even in the planning stages, we can start with here's my user requirements. And I put those in a document. I put that in TeamForge. I created my stories. I built it all out in TeamForge, or you can do that in Jira. And create those stories, create your tasks to go with it, do the actual coding, take it through a build. So here we can actually have an automated build. So when I do my commits or my check-ins, I can have it automate my builds using either a Jenkins build or maybe a Maven's build. I can take it through the lifecycle, have it automated. I can give it automated reviews if I wanted to. I can assign it to different people. One of the things that you can do with the review process is that there are rules around it such that if I didn't want the user who made the changes to review his own code, I could block that. So I could put rules in place that says, no, the user who made these changes can't do his own review. He has to assign it to other people to do that review. So go through the review process. I mean, you can use Garrett for your code reviews if you want to do that. Or there's also a tool for doing reviews. Testing. Take it through the release cycle. And here's kind of where we get into some new features for the deployment, is that now I can actually start with that deployment, and I can set thresholds and boundaries. So maybe there's too much activity that's going on with your deployment. So I can say, why am I getting all this activity? Maybe there's some red flags. And I can put things in there so that it could automatically generate a ticket if it finds out that there's too much activity. You get the ability to create workflows. You can talk about different relics. Maybe you want to see the CPU usage for a new relic. You can show traceability to all of the actual changes that have been made. So before you do this deployment, you want to know exactly what changed, who changed it, where was it changed, how was it changed, all of that done in TeamForge. And then you can do your deploy. You can track that deployment too so that you actually recreate that deployment. So this is some of the things that's new that's coming. You can control how the tools are going to interact in your tool chain. So you're going to see here, you're going to get all those new relics, and I can put things in place such that I can control the monitoring of the CPU usage for that relic. So these are things that's coming down the tool chain. So we want to talk about our DevOps solution. So these are things that are coming. And I think I'm going to stop right there. We got about 5 minutes left, 6 minutes left, and see if you guys have any questions.